night. I've had a day.
Say, Wiz, can you help me out? Thanks, bro.
Is everything all right?
My romantic comedy is a romantic tragedy.
Michelle, I can't live without you.
Man, why do we always come to the movies?
You can learn a lot from a movie.
To make.
Nothing's been the same since New York. You experience things, and then they're over. I can't sleep. And when I do, I have nightmares.
Honestly, there's 100 people who want to kill me.
I hope I can protect the one thing I can't live without. Signatures disable with extreme prejudice.
Yes!
What are you waiting for? It's Christmas. Take him to church.
Gentlemen.
To steady this thing.
This is how you've been managing your downtime, huh?
Everybody needs a hobby. Heartbreaker, help Red Snapper out, will you?
Suit, okay?
Oh, I'm sorry, they're only coded to me.
What does that mean?
I got you covered.
Good evening, Cub. Can I give you a lift?
Very funny.
Yeah, I figured some of you guys would like that, and of course some of you ladies, because I know there are some good superhero fans out in the crowd, right? We love a superhero movie. Believe it or not, like I tweeted this out earlier this week, that is the number one most grossing Christmas movie of all time. Now, I know you guys think, like, Christmas movie, it's technically a movie set at Christmas, but for superhero fans, it's the number one Christmas movie of all time. Like, it grossed, I don't know, it was like $1.2 or $3 billion around the world. Iron Man and the whole Marvel Universe is just ridiculous. But I enjoy that movie, and that's my favorite scene, because when all of those robots show up, like, you're not expecting it. Like, it's a little twist. You don't really expect all of the Iron Man suits and all the different suits to show up. And for me, it just kind of reminds me of Christmas. Of Christmas. There's this scene in the Christmas story where a lot of these sort of glowing things in the air show up. Anybody help me out here? Anybody remember that in the Christmas story in Luke chapter 2 when something shows up and kind of surprises somebody? Anybody know what that is? Okay, I got one person, angels. Thank you, Fallon. Angels. We're going to kick off in Luke chapter 2. I'm going to go somewhere with Iron Man this morning. We're going to go somewhere with a story, with the Christmas story and the movie. But we're going to start in Luke chapter 2. I love there in that scene when he says, you know, what are you waiting for? It's Christmas. Take him to church, right? I mean, that should be in every movie. Come on, it's Christmas. Take him to church. There's your reminder. Grab some invite cards, right? Go find all your friends and bring them to church on Christmas Eve. Okay, take them to church. So we're going to be in Luke chapter 2. This is like the super traditional Christmas story, right? I mean, this is what every church reads during their Christmas service. This is what every family, when they gather around the Christmas tree at Christmas time, and they're going to read the Christmas story from the Bible, they're going to read from Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2 is what we read from all the time, and it's so familiar to us, but I think sometimes we sometimes forget just how powerful Luke chapter 2 is. So I'm going to pick up in verse 7. In verse 7, so Mary and Joseph, they've been traveling. They've been called back to their homeland because there's a census being taken, and so they need to go back to the city, basically to their family's birthplace. So they're headed back to Bethlehem, right? And so they've gone back to Bethlehem. Mary is great with child. She's about to have baby Jesus. In verse 7, it says this, she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. Remember that. There was no lodging available for them. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. Don't be afraid, he said, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. Verse 11, the Savior, yes, the Messiah. This is what they have been waiting for the entire existence of the Hebrew people. Anybody that you've ever met who would identify as Jewish, they would say, we're looking for the Messiah, we're looking for the Messiah, we're looking for the Messiah. And what this angel showed up and said was, he's here. We need some backup. Oh, what is that I see in the distance? He's here. The Messiah is here. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, capital L, the Lord has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger. Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, like, when we picture angels, we see like these fluttery little butterfly things with harps that are playing. And, you know, maybe when you picture angels, you see like the little infant angels in diapers, you know, like in holy diapers with the little wings on the back of them. And they're playing a little harp. You know, it's like a Pampers or a Charmin commercial. But that's not an angel. This is the heavenly army. I think Iron Man 3 is probably closer to what an angel might look like than the way we typically see angels portrayed. This is a heavenly army. The armies of heaven show up praising God and saying, verse 14, glory to God in highest heaven and peace on earth to those whom God is pleased. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. But Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them. Wow. Well, I mean, like, this is one of those awesome moments. Like, this is, if not the climax of humanity, this is the next to the top, right? We might say that crucifixion or the resurrection is the ultimate climax of God's story. But this is definitely, definitely, definitely one of those high points, right? And it's so amazing that, like, it separates our calendar. It separates, it changed history forever. And we read about it and we celebrate it every year, not just in America, but around the world. Not every country, not every culture, but around the world, Christmas is celebrated because Jesus was born and the shepherds told people about it. I want you to just listen to that for a second. We're celebrating today because the Savior was born and the shepherds told people about it. Like, if the angel had just showed up and the shepherds went, "Well, that was no big deal. Let's just go back to keeping our sheep." Like, we may not know. But God chose these ordinary men doing an ordinary job. They were ordinary people going about their ordinary day. And God interjected himself and showed them who the Messiah was. And they went and they visited him and it blew them away. And they told people about it. Their lives were forever, forever changed. Here's the message of Christmas. The message of Christmas is life-changing. The message of Christmas is life-changing. It's all about life change. Like, it's not about getting stuff. There's nothing wrong with getting stuff. But for most of you, if not all of you, whatever is under your tree or maybe parked in your driveway with a big red bow, if you go that far, right? But or maybe like parked on the trailer that you pull behind the thing parked in your driveway, you know, whatever that is, whatever's under your tree, no matter how big or how small, when you open it this Christmas, it's going to be old next Christmas. It's probably not going to be life-changing. Right? You're going to want the new version next year. You're going to want something else next year. Listen, there is no new version of Christianity. There is no new, like, Jesus once and for all time was the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus knew what he came to do, and he came and he did it. The message of Christmas is that Jesus came to change your lives. What we say at this church, you can go to tcaf.com/our-code, or just go to tcaf.com and look for our code and read it. And what it will say on that page, our message is this: Jesus changes everything. Jesus changes everything. Specifically, online it says Jesus and his word changes everything. But the reality is the word would not exist without Jesus. Jesus changes everything. And what your friends and your coworkers and your kids and your family, what they need to hear this Christmas is that your life is different because of Jesus. That their lives can be different because of Jesus. That their marriages, their jobs, like everything about it. Is it going to be perfect? No, it's not. But Jesus changes everything. These shepherds, they were changed. As far as we know, they went back to their fields. Like, they went back to their daily life. They didn't follow Jesus. They didn't become disciples. They didn't like quit their jobs and go to work for the church full time. No. They went back to their daily lives. They went back to the day-in, day-out grind of chasing down the sheep and fighting off the wolves or whatever they had to do. They made a living. It wasn't easy. But they told people about Jesus. They had a Messiah. They had a Savior that they had seen with their own eyes, that they'd experienced with their life, and it changed them. It changed who they were and who they were becoming. They told people about it, and you're sitting here today because they told people about it. There are people who ought to be in this auditorium next Christmas because somebody told them about Christmas. Not just about our Christmas Eve services. Yes, invite people to that. But somebody shared with them Christmas. And yes, everybody in the South's heard about Jesus, and they know that Jesus is the reason for the season, and you don't put an X because you don't want to take Christ out of Christmas. I don't know if you've noticed my hashtags, but they are hashtag TCAF Xmas, right? I mean, like, that's not a big deal. The big deal is Christ. The big deal is Jesus. That's who we should be talking about this Christmas season. Now, their lives were changed. What I want to talk about this morning is kind of that change, but I want to do it through a little another avenue, a little bit different story. You're going to have to hang with me here, but you can go ahead in your Bibles and start going to 2 Samuel. If you've got a paper Bible, if you've got a digital Bible, it's going to be 2 Samuel chapter 19. I'm not going to go there yet. I want to go back to Iron Man, but we're going to be in 2 Samuel 19 in just a minute. But Iron Man, Iron Man 3, the movie. We love superhero movies, right? Like, we love, I don't know if some of you got, Robbie, I'm sure you were probably like me, because, like, when it first came on, he was like, woohoo, yeah, right? He's behind me. But, like, when that action scene was going on, I don't know about the rest, like, my heart started pounding, right? I mean, like, it was intense. And when you're in a giant screen movie theater, it gets intense. And, you know, a lot of times we go to the movie theater to just sort of escape. We want to, like, guys, we like to see things blow up. It's so much fun. Like, and in real life, we want to go get some Tannerite and go out in the woods and, like, shoot it from a distance and watch things blow up. Like, we just enjoy that. But the reality is, the reason that Iron Man 3 was such a huge box office hit and remains kind of Marvel's, like, flagship superhero, honestly, is the storytelling. It's the way that they weave this character and how you love to hate him, but you love to love him, and you go back and forth. And Iron Man 3 is all about life change. It's all about, like, the underlying current of the whole movie. If you've never seen it, most every character in the movie has gone through some sort of transformation. Even Tony Stark kind of goes through this transformation. So, like, the first one, I've got a picture, is the Iron Patriot. Like Rhodey, the black guy in the video, like, that's Rhodey, that's his friend. He's Colonel. I don't even remember his whole name because he just calls him Rhodey. But he was War Hero War Machine, and now they've rebranded him because, you know, he's going to be for America, right? So he's become the Iron Patriot at the beginning of the movie. And then we've got this evil villain. Let's see the Mandarin here. Ooh, doesn't he look evil? Doesn't he look evil? I don't know if you. If you haven't seen the movie, I'm just going to go ahead and give it away for you if you decide. Yeah, spoiler alert. He's not as evil as you think he is. When they actually find him, he's this washed-up drug addict actor who's playing a part. He's looking evil just so he can get more money to buy drugs, basically. And he's not evil at all. He's not even the villain. But he's changing himself. He's transforming himself to be what they expect him to be. He's really not that evil. But then you've got this guy, the next guy. There you go. He's like the clean-cut, good-looking businessman. He starts the movie off as this nerdy scientist who's, like, created this amazing invention, and he's showing it off, and all the ladies are swooning because he's gone from this nerd to this super hot hunk who's really smart and has lots of money and drives nice cars. And guess who he is? The villain, right? Of course he is. And it's all about him, like, literally going through this physical transformation. Well, not only is he, like, this, you know, super hot hunky guy, but he's, like, literally lava hot and burning through things, and he's trying to kill Iron Man. And then you've got Pepper Potts. Pepper is, like, she's married, like, she's Iron Man's girl, and she's with Tony, and she's trying to figure all this out, like, how do I live with this crazy guy who's also a superhero, and then I've got my own, you know, things that I want to do, and she goes through another physical transformation herself. And then finally, you've got the main character, Tony Stark. And in this movie, you see him, like, hit rock bottom. Like, literally, he hits the bottom of the ocean. But he hits rock bottom. He ends up in, of all places, Chattanooga, Tennessee, with a boy who might as well be, like, him as a boy, who's, like, super smart, and he's, like, rebuilding the suit, and the boy's helping him out, and he messes with, like, he keeps making fun of the boy, but really the boy's, you know, he's this lovable character, and it's about him as a man trying to figure out this question. What really makes Iron Man Iron Man? Like, all the way through the movie, that's really the underlying question that they're asking. What makes Iron Man Iron Man? Is it the suit? Is it the money? Is it the brains? What is it that really makes Iron Man the superhero that we all love? What makes Iron Man Iron Man? Well, to answer this question, I want to go to 2 Samuel chapter 19. Because This is one of those obscure Bible stories that you've probably never heard before. And even if you've read through the whole Bible, you've probably never heard before, because you just, like, you just breezed right through this and you thought, that's just weird, it doesn't make any sense, I'm just going to keep going. But this is one of those stories that I think for this series, for this week, let's just pause with all, like, what we're familiar with, and let's maybe look at something that we're not so familiar with, and I believe we can mine for some amazing gold and find out the answer to the question, what really makes Iron Man, Iron Man? So 2 Samuel chapter 19, we're going to pick up in verse 31. It's going to be on the screen if you don't have it in front of you. I'm reading from the New International Version this morning, and here's what it says, verse 31. Oh, that's a hard name to say. Barzillai. Barzillai. Everybody say Barzillai. Barzillai. Barzillai the Gileadite. Ooh, like I've already flipped the page, right? If I'm reading through the Bible, the B, the G, I'm gone to the next page. All right, let's stay with me. I promise you, this is going to be good. Barzillai the Gileadite also came down from Rogelim to cross the Jordan with the king and sent him on his way from there. Now, let me back up just a little bit. Who's the king? Who's the king? This king referred to here is King David, all right? You've probably heard of King David. We're talking about David who killed Goliath, David who ran from Saul, David that I love to preach about. Probably the only Bible character other than Jesus that I love more than David is David's best friend, Jonathan. But this is King David, and here's what's been going on for King David. He's been king for a while. He's got a couple of sons. His sons have basically been fighting over who's going to get to take over the kingdom when David is gone. And David has lived through battles and wars, and he's kind of adopted this sort of hands-off approach that he really just, he doesn't want to be bloody anymore. And so he literally retreats. He gets out of town. He runs away from Jerusalem. And one of his sons comes in and starts warring and taking over. His name's Absalom. And eventually, Absalom, he's another one of those hunky guys, you know, that like every girl swoons over. He's got this long, beautiful hair. And it's the pride of Absalom, right? And eventually what happens is Absalom's riding on his horse, and he's in battle, and he rides up under a low-hanging tree, and the tree branches grab that hair and string him up. And some of David's soldiers defy his original order and kill the son of David. It's very sad. It's very moving. But it was also very necessary for this story to continue. And so Absalom is dead. David has begun to mourn him in chapter 19. And David is returning to Jerusalem. Now, what happens before chapter 19 is in chapter 18. There you go. What happens in chapter 18 is while David's on the run, this guy named Barzillai and some other people, but mainly this guy, they help David out. When David is hungry, when his men don't have food to eat, and he's kind of hiding out, and he's sort of sneaking back in, or his men are sneaking back in and out, and you know they're trying to figure out what's going on, Barzillai helps David. He risks his own life because Absalom could have him killed. He risks his family. Him and a few other people, they risk everything that they have to help David while David's on the run. So now David is returning. His son is dead. He's returning. He's coming back to Jerusalem, and he stops to see Barzillai. The king stops to see one of his trusted servants, one of the men who has helped him. That's in verse 31. Verse 32, now Barzillai was very old, 80 years of age. He had provided for the king during his stay at Mahanaim. That's what I was telling you about. Happened in verse 18. For he was a very wealthy man. Verse 33, the king said to Barzillai, cross over with me and stay with me in Jerusalem, and I will provide for you. Now, pause just a second. King David, man after God's own heart, king of the kingdom, is saying to a man who's 80 years old, dude, you're at retirement age. You're still working hard. Yes, you're wealthy. I mean, the Bible says that he's a wealthy man, but he's no king. And what David is saying to Barzillai is, look, just travel with me. Come back to Jerusalem with me. Because you helped me in a time of need, I'm going to take care of you for the rest of your life. Wouldn't we all volunteer for that, right? Like, yes, take me. Let's go. The king wants me to go live in the palace. I'm there. I'm going to eat bonbons and watch YouTube for the rest of my life. I don't even know what a bonbon is, and I'm pretty sure they didn't have YouTube back then. All right, verse 34, but Barzillai answered the king, How many more years will I live that I should go up to Jerusalem with the king? I'm now 80 years old. Can I tell the difference between what is enjoyable and what is not? Can your servant taste what he eats and drinks? Can I still hear the voices of male and female singers? Why should your servant be an added burden to the Lord the king? Your servant will cross over the Jordan with the king for a short distance, but why should the king reward me in this way? Let your servant return that I may die in my own town near the tomb of my father and mother. All right, pause right there. Barzillai says, King, you know, it's tempting. I'm just going to have to pass this time. And he gives us several reasons why. And quite frankly, they all make pretty good sense. I mean, they're pretty good excuses. I think a lot of times in life, when the king wants us to come with him, it's really easy for us to make excuses. It's really easy for us to say to God, it's really easy for us to respond to the Holy Spirit, to respond to the calling of our King, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's really easy to respond to him when he encourages us, leads us, prompts us, calls us to do something. It's really easy for us to make some excuses that, quite frankly, they make perfect sense, right? At least in our minds, we're completely justified. As a matter of fact, we'd probably even sit down with our friends and family and our coworkers and say, you know, Pastor, I know that sounds good. I realize it's the right thing to do, but I've got this other thing going on. But there's all kinds of buts that get in the way. So I want to very quickly look at five excuses. But before I get to the five excuses that Barzillai makes, I want you to understand why I chose this story. The name Barzillai. I love names. The name Barzillai means this, Iron Man. His name means man of iron. He has this iron will that's very hard to change. He's been a warrior. He's been a wealthy man. He's been someone who really has probably ruled with like an iron fist. And he's become known to his friends, his family, as Iron Man. And so here's Iron Man facing off against the king. And Iron Man is saying to the king, you know what, king? I really appreciate the opportunity, but I'm just going to have to pass. So Iron Man ought to have some pretty good excuses, right? He's got five. Number one, he says, my age. How many more years will I live that I should go up to Jerusalem with the king? I'm 80 years old. That's the end of verse 34 and the beginning of 35. I'm 80 years old. He says, it's my age. You know, I'd really like to do something for God, but I'm just too old. You know, Sarah said that. She was like 100 years old, and then she had a baby in the Bible. I'm just too old. If you're in this room and you're old, I'm not going to define old, all right? I'll define it that you're older than me, because that's about half the room probably. You're older than me. You might call yourself old. Listen, God's not finished with you because you're old. God's not finished with you. He's not finished working on you. You are his workmanship, and you are not complete yet. God is still working on you, working in you, and God I hope for you that God's working through you because he wants to. If you're still breathing, if you still have breath in your lungs, God's not finished with you. There is so much that you can do for God that should not be an excuse that keeps us. And for those of you who are young, I'll define young this way, younger than me, right? Younger than me, because that's probably about, there you go, that's probably about half the room, right? Younger than me, listen, what did Paul say to Timothy? Timothy was like, but I'm just a young guy. I don't know really how to lead this church. I don't have the experience. Timothy's like, Paul says to Timothy in the New Testament, don't let people look down on you because you're young. Just because you're a teenager, just because you're a 20-something, that doesn't mean that you can't lead. Some of the best leaders that I've ever served with and had the privilege to serve with were like 19 and 20 years old, and they were amazing. Listen, you can be, I mean, I read all the time about young kids who are changing the world because they decided to, like, take up turkeys for their local food shelter. And before you know it, like, the whole world has given them hundreds of thousands of dollars in turkeys at Christmas and at Easter. because an 8-year-old decided to do a fundraiser for food for the homeless. Like, God can use you to change the world, regardless of what your age is. But often we say things like, I can't, right? I'm too old. I'm too young. Or we might say something like this, at this stage in my life, right? Like, okay, you might not say you're too old or you're too young, but I've said this one. I bet some of you have said this one. At this stage in my life, I just started this new job. At this stage in my life, I can't do that right now. My wife's pregnant. At this stage in my life, I don't want to take on a new responsibility. I've got 4 kids. At this stage in my life, I've got a teenager. I've got like a teenager and a tween. And I mean, mine are 13, 11, 9, and 7. And last fall, we had something going every night of the week. At this stage in my life, I just can't. It's really easy to say, right? It's really easy to make excuses. And what God says is, look, at this stage in your life, you're right where I want you so that I can use you at this stage in your life to take ground for the kingdom. The second thing that Barzillai says, the second excuse that he makes is he says, first there's my age, but now it's my ability. It's my ability, right? He says, can I tell the difference between what's enjoyable and what's not? Can your servant taste what he eats and drinks? Can I still hear the voices of male and female singers? But pastor, I can't carry a tune in a bucket. I don't know how to play the instruments on stage. I've never led a small group before. I'm not, like, if I open the door, I might trip over somebody. I've got 2 left feet. I don't know how to greet people. I don't know how to slide the little buttons. I really, I'm just kind of quiet. And I don't really talk to people at work. And so I don't even know how to invite them. Like, I don't have the ability. You have the Spirit of the living God living inside of you. If you have trusted Jesus as your Savior, the Holy Spirit indwells you. And God says, I have not given you a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Like, the Holy Spirit is possessing your body right now. Now, not in a way that's like evil and he's controlling all your actions. But what I'm telling you is, you are sealed with the Spirit for the day of redemption. And the same strength that raised Jesus from the dead is in you. You cannot make the excuse, I don't have that ability. If you are a Christian, like, you're not allowed. Okay? I mean, like, and I know that's hard. And yes, we all have different personalities. And absolutely, we all have different abilities. We all have different gifts. But to say, I have no ability, is to call God a liar. Because when God calls you, God equips you. And when God asks you to do something, he says, I'm going to be with you every step of the way. I'm never leave you. I'm never going to forsake you. I teach people that we serve a never, never, always God. You're never alone. He never gives you too much. And he always gives you a way out when you're standing in the face of temptation. But God is always with you. I don't have the ability. It's just an excuse that we need to mark off our list. Because let me say this. If you were ever able to do what God asks you to do, who gets the credit? Thank you. I want you to think about it for a second. If you are able to do anything, who gets the credit? You do. Of course God calls you when you're not able. Of course God called these 12 men that we call disciples, who one was a tax collector that everybody hate. You know, half of them were fishermen. Like these guys were guys that everybody overlooked because they had no ability to lead the church. They all literally failed. They were VBS dropouts because every little Jewish boy went to Jewish school and they all started learning like the book of Isaiah, and eventually like their teachers all walked in and went like, Peter, yeah, you need to go home and join your dad as a fisherman because you failed that last test. I mean, like, every one of them, none of them were able, and Jesus gave them the supernatural ability to get us where we are today. When God enables you, God gets the glory and God gets the credit. Just take that my ability and mark it off your list. Number 3, the third thing that he says, his third excuse is my burden. Or more specifically, I am the burden. He says, why should your servant be an added burden to my Lord the King? All right, now imagine this for just a second. Your bar's a lie. You're a fairly wealthy guy to start with, but you're no king, right? Now, fast forward like, you know, 12 months down the road, or for us, like to April the 15th. What's April the 15th? Tax day, all right? It's Christmas. King David shows up, says, hey, follow me. Like, come to my kingdom. We say, okay, I'll go with you, but I'm going to warn you now, I'm a little bit of a burden, right? And so fast forward a few months to April 15th, tax day, and here comes all of King David's, like, financial advisors and his tax assessor, and they gather around in the courtroom. They look at King David, and they're like, you know, David, we've gone through all the numbers, but we're just going to have to fold the kingdom because Barzillai came in at Christmas time. We just can't make it because he's too big of a burden. Of course not. Like, that's ridiculous, right? And I think sometimes we, not all of us, but some of us feel that way about the church. Some of us feel that way about serving God, that because of maybe our age or our lack of ability or whatever, we would just say, well, I mean, if I show up, they don't really need me. I'll just be a burden. I'll just get in my way, or in their way. Or I've got 4 kids. Y'all've got 6 kids. Some of you others have 2 and 3 kids. And you'll say, like, I mean, I would go, but I've got all these kids, and like, they'll be a burden. They'll be in the way. And I just can't go and be a part of that because of the burden that I'll place. Okay, again, pause, hit the pause button, step back, and let me remind you. King of kings, Lord of lords, creator of the universe. Everything that has ever existed, God made. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, right? God can afford you and your burden. And you know what else he can afford? Your baggage. But pastor, I've been divorced. But pastor, I had an abortion. But pastor, you don't know what happened to me when I was 19. You don't know how I acted when I was 25. You don't know what I did last weekend. You know what God says to that? I can afford you. As a matter of fact, I sent my son, whose blood is priceless, to buy you back. We use this great big word in church called redemption. Redeem means to buy back. That's why Jesus came. He paid the price for your burdens, for your baggage, once and for all time when he died on the cross. Again, go back to your list of excuses. And when you say, I may be too much of a burden, just mark that one off the list because Jesus did it with his blood. Number 4, he says, my duty. Now, this is kind of one of those weird ones, like, how is this an excuse, my duty? And here's what I mean by this one. Like, sometimes we make the excuse, like, we actually say yes, but we only say yes as far as it's our duty. Like as far as we think we have to go to make somebody happy or to please God, to make God happy. Here's what Barzillai says to King David. He says, your servant will cross over the Jordan with the king for a short distance. He's like, King, I realize, like, I mean, you're like my best friend, you're my bro, and I'm old, and I really want to go to Jerusalem with you, but I really just can't. So I'll tell you what, to make you happy, to satisfy you, to fulfill my duty as your servant and your friend, I'm going to go halfway. Because from where they were across the Jordan River was somewhere between 20 and 25 miles. And from where they crossed the Jordan River to Jerusalem was about another 20 or 25 miles. And what Barzillai is saying to David is, I'll go with you halfway, and then I'll come back. Like, would you ever say that to God? I mean, really, face to face to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, God says, I want you to do something for me. Well, you know, God, I'll do it, but you're going to have to meet me halfway, or I'm only going to go halfway. Or I'm going to keep moving in this direction as long as you're providing for me and as long as you open all the doors and as long as everything seems to be okay. Because, God, if everything's okay and all the doors open and everything just lines up perfectly and I get the budget that I need and I get the yeses that I need and all the stuff that I need, as long as you give me everything that I need and I don't feel any pain, I'll go. But you've got to meet me halfway, God. I would not be at this church if I ever said that. I probably wouldn't have been at any church I've ever served at. And I'm not saying that, like, you've only gone halfway because you're not on staff. This is just my life. But listen, we moved 1,000 miles away from home to South Florida. And you better believe that our prayer was, God, make it easy. Right? God, make it easy for us to get there. And thank God he made it easy. But what I realized in moving to South Florida and then moving back to Mississippi and then moving back up here, that my prayer, like, God had mercy on me in my ignorance and my stupidity. Right? As your pastor, I can stand here and say that my prayer, like, I don't know that any prayer is actually a wrong prayer, but I'm going to say that my prayer was a wrong prayer. My prayer was like, God, make it easy for me, and then I'll know that I should go. That's not how God operates all the time. God says, go whether it's easy or hard, and I'm going to provide for you along the way. That's usually how it works, and it's not always easy. God does not promise us that life is going to be easy. What God promises us is that when life is hard, he's right there with us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And so you can just take that little excuse and mark it off your list. Because let me ask you this question. What if Jesus only went halfway? What if he was just born at Christmas and he was like, okay, God the Father, I get it. Like, you know, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they're having their Holy Trinity, you know, staff meeting. You know, they're around the round table, probably all holding hands because I'm sure that's what they do. I don't know how that works, but you know. You know, it's the Trinity in heaven around the table, and they're like, and Jesus is like, okay, God, I get it. You've got this plan. You're going to send me to earth. Like, I'm going to have to take off all the majesty of heaven. I'm going to have to put aside all the power that has existed outside of time and even inside of time. I got to put all of that away, and you want me to become a human being and be born? Do you know how gross that is? But I'll do it. But that's all I'll do. Like, I'm gonna be born, and then I'm gonna, like, turn into an adult and save humanity. Right, God the Father, high five, like, let's do it. I'm gonna go halfway. No. That's not what Jesus did. He went all the way. Yes, he was born. Yes, he was a boy. Yes, I don't know how this works, but it says in Luke 2:52 that Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. Like, I don't know how this works, but apparently Jesus was a dumb little boy. I don't know how that works. Like, I don't know how. I know you laugh, but he grew in wisdom. And then when the Bible says something, I believe the Bible is true. So apparently, Jesus made some mistakes as a child. Can I say that in church? Like, I'm not talking about he sinned, because I believe that we serve a sinless, spotless lamb. But, like, maybe he burned his hand on the eye, right? Or, you know, like, he went to give a dog a treat, and he stuck his hand out, and the dog bit his finger, right? I mean, like, he didn't get everything right as a kid because he grew in wisdom and in stature. And again, I don't know how that works, because at some point, the majesty, the power, the full knowledge of God was a part of Jesus' life. But as a boy, he experienced life as a boy. And I'm just going to tell you, as a boy, it ain't always fun. And I'm pretty sure it's not always fun as a girl either. But he didn't come as a girl. He came as a boy. And Jesus went all the way. He was 100% man, 100% God. When they put the nails in his arms, in his hands, in his feet, it hurt. And he did it anyway. He shed his blood for us, because we do not serve a halfway God. We serve Jesus, who went all the way for us. Barzillai's fifth excuse: my family, my home, the place I grew up, the people that I love who are behind me. He says this. So after he says, I'm going to go with you halfway, I'll cross over the Jordan, he says, but let your servant return that I may die in my own town near the tomb of my father and mother. Listen, in North Mississippi speak, Mamaw and Papaw are buried back there, and I intend to be buried right beside them. We allow our families to be excuses all the time. We, as a community in the South, a lot of you, not all of you, but a lot of you, you grew up here. You could never imagine moving away. My beautiful wife, I think, was 3 years old when her parents were founding members of this church, and she grew up here. Like, she was Mary in the Christmas play as a little girl, right? It was I don't know how old you were, but like 5 or 6 years old. Like, she grew up in this church, and then she married me. The crazy guy who's moved 24 times in 40 years, or whatever the number is. It's ridiculous. and we moved. But there was a point for her, and there's a point for a lot of you that you just could not, you could not imagine leaving your family, moving away. You couldn't imagine some of you even leaving your kids with a babysitter for a night or two so you could go on a mission trip or so that you could go help the church do something. So often, we allow our family ties, our family responsibilities to keep us from serving God. And again, I'm just going to say this. When you trust Jesus as your Savior, you're part of His family. And His family's everywhere. Jesus himself said when his mom and his brother showed up one night to talk to him and they wanted to come in and Jesus was meeting with a lot of people, Jesus said, who's my mother and brother? Who's my family? It's the people who do my will. It's the people who obey me. It's the people who have trusted me as their Savior and placed their faith and trust in me. They become children of God. Like, you are not called a servant. You are not even called a disciple. By God, you are called friends, and you are called family. God has chosen you to be His child, and God is not finished with you yet. Don't make all those excuses that Barzillai made. But the story doesn't end there. Barzillai doesn't end there. You see, Barzillai, if you continue reading, he risked his life to help David. And this Iron Man is risking everything in this moment. And yes, he's making these excuses that we can learn from. But what Barzillai is actually doing is setting himself up, yes, to be removed from the situation. But it's not just so he can go home and be married with Mama and Papa in the backyard. He's removing himself so that he can insert someone else. Keep reading. Verse 37. He says, let your servant return that I might die in my own town near the tomb of my father and mother. But here is your servant Kimham. Let him cross over with the Lord the king. Do for him whatever you wish. Kimham was apparently either the son or the grandson, probably the son of Barzillai. And what Barzillai is actually saying, what this Iron Man is actually saying is, listen, King David, yes, there's all kinds of excuses. I believe that Barzillai would actually still go. As I read this story, I believe that Barzillai would actually still go. But what he is doing is he's realized he's good where he is. He is already a servant of the king, loved by the king, favored by the king, blessed by the king. And where he is, he gets to be a blessing to the kingdom. But there's another one. There's another generation. There's the next generation coming behind Barzillai. His name is Kimham. And what Barzillai is saying to the king, to David, is take the next generation. Do for him what you would do for me. Where I would walk with you, let him walk with you. Where I would learn from you, let him learn from you. Where I would be blessed by you, bless him. And King David says, okay, I will take the next generation. Listen, at the church at Lake Forest, we say we're for our neighbors and the next generation. I'm not telling you to make these same excuses. That's not what I'm encouraging you to do. But what I am saying is let no excuse stand in your way of investing in the next generation. In the words of Tony Stark, what are you waiting for? Take him to church. That's what Barzillai is saying to King David. And that's what God has called us to do, to introduce the next generation to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, so that where he walks, they will walk. Where he teaches, they will learn. When he blesses, they receive the blessing. Because let's be honest, we are richly blessed. Most of us in this auditorium, I'm going to say everybody who's older than me, we have been blessed. You may not have everything that you want, but we have been blessed, and it's our turn to give it back to the next generation. And everybody who's younger than me, who maybe is not a child. Listen, God's been blessing you too. And one day, your day is going to come. And listen, it may be tomorrow. Because I'm not just talking about physical age. I'm talking about spiritual age too. Just because you're older doesn't necessarily mean you're wiser. But if you are older and if you've been walking with God longer and you are wiser, you know this is the truth. 3 John 1:4 says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. That's been one of my life's verses for a long time. We should all say that we have no greater joy than to see the next generation walking with the King, being blessed by the King. After all, isn't that what Jesus did? Isn't that what Jesus did? Didn't Jesus give his all for us so that we could walk with the King? We are his next generation. Here's what Barzillai did and what I want to encourage you to do. When you feel like you have nothing left to give, wherever you are in life, whatever you would say, like, I don't have the ability, I'm too old, I don't have the money, I don't have the time, my family's holding me back, whatever it is, when you feel like you have nothing left to give, give your all so that the next generation may walk with the King. Listen, when you've got nothing, do you know how easy it is to give it away? Right? When you feel like you're at the end and you have nothing left to give, you know what you do? You give it all. When you feel like I've got nothing to give God, and so what I'm going to say to God is, God, like, come on, between me and you, like, I've got nothing. I'm at the end of my rope. I don't know what to do with these kids. I don't know what to do with my finances. I don't know what to do with my spouse. I've got nothing. I've got nothing left to give. So you know what, God? I'm just going to give it all to you. You know how easy that should be? We don't do it nearly often enough. But it should be easy when we have nothing left to give. Just give it all away. And you know what happens when we give everything that we have to the next generation? God blesses you. God blesses you. God blesses that next generation. Now, you read a little bit, you read through Kim Ham's story, and King David takes him back. He travels. He tells Barzillai, absolutely, like, you know, you stay here. Be buried with Mama and Papa in the backyard. I'm going to take Kim Ham under my wing. And David leaves. And as you continue to read through the rest of 2 Samuel, like, that's it. That's the end of the story. Except it's not. There's this little nugget sort of buried in the story that we're gonna get to in a minute. I left one thing out. Thanks for popping that up on the screen. Let's go back to verse 38. The king says this to Kim Ham and to Barzillai. Kim Ham shall cross over with me, and I will do for him whatever you wish. And I underline this part. And anything you desire from me, I will do for you. Listen, when you give all that you have to the king, I said this a second ago, the king's going to bless you. Because Barzillai gave everything that he had for David. Like, he was willing to do that for David. And then he inserted Kim Ham, this next generation. What David was saying back to Barzillai is, yeah, I'm going to take him, but I'm still going to bless you, right? I'm going to do the right thing. I'm going to take on the next generation, but I still want to bless you. Anything you desire from me, I will do for you. When you give your all so that the next generation can walk with the king in the kingdom, the king promises a reward. And that is awesome. That God wants to reward us, but that is not the end of the story. It seems like it is. You read through the rest of 2 Samuel, you think it's over, but it's not. So I told you I was going to try to tie Iron Man, and I did, to this story. What in the world could this story possibly have to do with Christmas? Right? I mean, is the only tie the fact that I picked an Iron Man movie? Maybe. Maybe not. Because there's this little nugget in another story about another group of people who are traveling. This is in Jeremiah 41:17. Here's what it says in Jeremiah 41:17. And they went on, stopping at Geruth-Kimham near Bethlehem on their way to Egypt. See, apparently what happened is that King David took Kimham back to the palace, to Jerusalem. I don't know how young he was, but King David probably taught him everything that he knew about following God, and because he was a man after God's own heart, and probably walked with him through his finances and getting his house in order and learning how to build a business, because David was a king after all, and he was pretty good at that. I mean, he was sort of like his own business owner as a teenager, keeping sheep and all that stuff. And so he apparently gifts Kimham this little plot of land. And Kimham, being an industrious young, the industrious young man that he is, apparently he starts a small business. He builds a home for his family. And inside that home, he begins building a business. And what we find out in Jeremiah chapter 41 is his business is fairly well known, because his business is called this Geruth Kimham. And people know it by name, and when they're traveling, they stop there, because they want to check out Geruth Kimham at Bethlehem. Geruth means this: a lodging place or an inn. Now, nowhere in Scripture does it tell us that this is absolutely true. But what if the inn of Kimham at Bethlehem was where all those years later the shepherds went to find baby Jesus? Because this is the inn at Bethlehem. And it was for generations. It was well known. It would have been like part of the family. And Mary and Joseph would have been looking for part of the family to stay with. And when it says there was no room for them at the inn might, I'm not saying it was, but it might have been this very Geruth Kimham at Bethlehem. What if Iron Man set the stage for Kimham to start a small business, to learn from the king, to walk with the king, to learn how to worship God, to manage his finances, to be prophet, priest, king, and warrior, to be the man that God wants him to be? And then God blessed his family in just this way that the baby Messiah was born in the cave in his backyard, in the stable, in a manger. I don't know that that happened, but God has a way of weaving things together. God has a way of making things happen outside of the ordinary. I mean, angels showed up, right? Here's what I want to tell you. You are sitting here today because the shepherds responded to the angels and told somebody. You're sitting here today because the 12 disciples didn't stay huddled in the upper room when the Holy Spirit showed up. They preached and thousands were added to the church, and people were added to the church every day. You're sitting here today because for the last couple thousand years, day after day after day, there have been iron men and iron women who would not give up. They would not make excuses. You are here today celebrating Christmas because somebody in your life, maybe it was a father or mother, a grandmother. Maybe it was a friend. Maybe it was a spouse invited you to church. Some of you, you've trusted Jesus as your Savior. Some of you, you're still trying to figure out exactly what faith is. But you're here because a man of iron didn't make excuses. A true iron man doesn't make excuses. The reality is, a true Iron Man doesn't even make a way. He simply follows the way. My encouragement to you this Christmas, this week, is to follow the way. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. When he calls you, follow after him. When you're at the point where you can invest in the next generation and you can encourage the next generation to follow after him, do that, because somebody did that for you.